buddy.
Großem persönlichen Interesse.
It's a great personal interest and pleasure for me to announce Rüdi and Volker, who will be telling you about
gesellschaftlichen Betriebssystem,
the societal operating system, and how we might be able to readjust it. And because I'm personally interested in what we're about to learn, please give a warm applause to Rüdi and Volker.
Ja, schönen guten Tag. Also es ist ja schon
bei der
Einleitung gesagt hat, Wissen of OS.
As mentioned in the introduction, Wisdom of OS, that might be a title that's not immediately obvious.
Erlaubt mir da,
so please allow me to
interessante Geschichte, wie eigentlich diese Idee dann doch
tell an interesting history, an interesting story, about how this was first debated and taken up. And I think it's cool to add a nerdy recursion layer. I was invited to speak about this on a conference on the digitization of education, and I had to smile because I used to be involved in many student associations, and this was the counterpart that always wanted to make universities more economically minded, and that's why I thought that we have to go there and tell them our opinion. And then I saw the next part of the invitation where they asked me, because this is a cross-subject conference, to use my professional experience. So I thought, all right, hold my beer. There are many interesting ways that operating systems and education interact. And so for the first part of my talk, I will be looking at this from a level of information science, and I'm very happy to have one of the most reputable media sociologists, Volker Grasmuck, with me. When we were preparing this talk, we enjoyed ourselves tremendously because this way of thinking about it that was very close to brainstorming was very entertaining. So I hope we'll be able to communicate some of that. When I saw the invitation, digitization of education, I reacted like, hello. We were the first to digitize our communication. We have millennia of experience as scientists, where we were with the idea that knowledge grows when it is shared. And the core part of the hacker spirit is much older than many people think, is one of the foundational parts of scientific discourse. So I thought I'd approach this step by step. What does digitization mean? And it can be helpful to focus on a technical point of view. So I found two points that are very interesting because they look at various aspects. There are two things you can see here. First, memory cost is going towards zero, plus epsilon. It's never going to reach zero, but it will tend towards zero. And the speed of communication grows towards infinity minus epsilon. Of course, Douglas Adams taught us that nothing moves faster than the speed of light, except for the spread of rumors. This is less fancy than you may think, because if you look at it, if you look at current processor speeds, we are starting to realize that for some problems, the speed of light is simply too slow. We are trying to predict the way that code will execute. So there are many interesting questions already here about simultaneousness But what I want to emphasize is that the cost of memory is tending towards zero, and the speed is growing towards infinity, and that has consequences. Everybody always laughs at these people who still think that the internet is an ancient technology, but it's not limited to that, because the largest hotel company in the world doesn't have any hotels, the largest taxi operator in the world doesn't have any taxis, so many things are being disrupted here. Complexity is growing monotonously, so it's getting more and more difficult to split things, and that is where we should think about what this means for education, because the world is getting more and more complex, it's getting more and more important to share experiences across subjects. And without spoiling the last slide, I believe that the dialogue across subjects and everything that doesn't fit into your curriculum, we need to have room for that. So the main priority must, the priority of shortening on study times is terrible in my opinion. But I took some time, and I have to admit this isn't from a science fiction perspective. I like one part of H.G. Wells. He wrote in 1938 a contribution named World Brain, where he wanted to check if resources can be allocated democratically. And Volker will be speaking a bit about this in more detail, but I want to make you aware that there's an article on World Brain in Wikipedia, which treats the topic and the question of whether or not Wikipedia might be an implementation of World Brain. So I urge you to have a look at this. And as a stubborn mathematician, I especially enjoyed the fact that in his first work, he doesn't really speak about networks. Instead, he uses this argument that memory is getting less expensive, so he proposes to store the world's knowledge on microfiche and distribute it. It's fun to think about this in an abstract way. He said we'd distribute microfiche in black and white. So this idea of using text for everything is very obvious, and well, it's colored when necessary. So he says if it's interesting, you can throw in some color as well. That's a debate that will make some of you smile, because the question of whether or not this is very necessary is a good one. So I think we should keep in mind that local storage is very cheap at the moment. The things we said at Camp 20 years ago, it's important to copy all the data because things disappear from the internet, is still valid. And looking at how storage costs have developed, I'm a fan of downloading scientific papers I'm interested in and never deleting them, because the cost of storing them is so low that the time of deciding whether or not to store things is more expensive. So if memory, if storage is getting less expensive, then we can think about redistributing. And if networks are getting more crowded and less stable, then maybe it could be interesting to say that we should have the option and use the option of storing things locally more than we do today. The next interesting part is Arthur C. Clarke. who also made some interesting predictions.
Also da werden die Leute gleich die leuchtenden Augen.
And some of you may remember 2001 and other things. He did things that appear far later. So if you want to make a metric of prophecy, it's a bit disadvantageous. But I invite you all to read him. It's fascinating that he proposed two steps. First, a word library, a lexicon or an encyclopedia for all. And he writes that the next step would be something like a network that thinks, an intelligent network. And that might be enough, but what I find almost uncanny is that he says that towards the 2000 we will have an encyclopedia and then we will reach artificial intelligence, and he predicted it nearly down to the year. I mean, it's the case that there are some interesting predictions here. Where does this come from? Why is that? As a mathematician, I can add another story by Alan Kay. The best way to predict the future is to invent it. And Alan Kay is the person who started object orienting as a concept. He's very unhappy about object oriented languages. He was at the forefront of graphical user interfaces and notebook concepts, and he developed these concepts already in the 1970s, even programming languages such as Smalltalk. So these are technologies that turned out to be all-encompassing decades later, and it's fascinating to see that these were first conceived in the 1970s. And there too we find the idea that's part of the hacker spirit. If we want to predict the future, we should massively try to invent it. Let's define some terms. Education as an operating system made me grin at first. What is an operating system? It is a hardware interface, which means that it organizes that things don't get in the way of each other, memory management and stuff, and a user interface who get a nice, a nicer interface. And what is education? It is an interface to scientific results. This should be very hard, very accurate, but it should also be an interface to humans. And to so, education as an operating system has some interesting thoughts, but I said I'd cut down. No, I'd have a bit of a longer technical part, and that's easy for me because, except for Windows, which is a slightly different case, and I want to talk about less about this, partly also because it's not really relevant for mobile platforms, but all the other operating systems has a very close connection to education. Minix was one of the first systems from 1987, which influenced the development of Linux. So Linus Torvalds learned from the Minix book. It was the first book that took operating systems seriously and saying that it's a topic that might not be very exciting mathematically, but it's very important, and we're going to do it, and we're also adding in some code. And that was a pioneering book, and it was in the interesting slot of time so that it became the blueprint for Linux. We have GNU, which is part of basically two important operating systems. First Emacs, which I use for my slides, and then GNU Linux, which is an interesting operating system, though it's not as widespread as Minix or Linux. And if you laugh, wait for two slides. And one more thing that's important is something that tells, well, it's interesting because minor changes can redefine an entire world. I'm under some time pressure, so let's hurry through this. Minix was developed in 1987 in Amsterdam, and what's crucial, the license was an annex to an educational book. So it was uncertain if this could be distributed. It was a very important system, and it was on the market in 1987. The only thing that was done wrong was the use of a wrong license. So most of you may not even know about Minix, or at least most people, which is an interesting implication. Another important license, which Volker is going to treat at some more length, is GPL, developed by Richard Stallman, which he first published in 1989 at the MIT. And we can say that GPL software is the backbone of digitization. Even Java and trade conflicts don't escalate entirely because parts of it are under GPL. Some more on this later. And I want to talk about Linux, which is the technological foundation of all Android systems and everything that happens in the smart home. Let's go get to BSD. The BSD license is the foundation of the Apple system. It's a license, and I'm going to show you a license in its entirety, which is a bad idea pedagogically. 1, 2, 3, done. So it's only three parts, and if you couldn't follow along, then I want to go one level of regression deeper. The new Minix 3 license was a BSD license, and Tannenbaum writes that it's a clone of the BSD license. Essentially, this means that you can do whatever you want to, apart from suing us. And if you know history, you know that if you say, please don't sue us, it always takes just a few days until the first lawsuit comes in. And of course, this is true in BSD as well. What's funny, though, and I almost dropped everything when I heard about this, is there were these drinking games in 2017. Whenever you have to say, when somebody says Russian hackers, you have to drink, because Russian hackers were apparently to blame for everything. I read that they're hacking Intel ME, and it turns out Intel ME uses Minix. I don't want to be disrespectful, but a badly phrased English error message was part of both Minix and this management engine. And I want to make you aware that Minix 3 runs on more operating more computers than Windows and macOS together, because it's part of all Intel systems that were that went to market after 2014. And I have to take a shortcut here. It was also I also enjoyed describing hacker ethics at length, which was another very important part of education that I contributed. But let's get to the final slides here. And this is interesting because it's a philosophical question as well. Does science have to be useful? And as a mathematician, my favorite quote is one which has been going around for a while, and it says that if mathematics is the queen of science, which nobody should doubt, then arithmetics, or the theory of numbers, is the queen of mathematics. And of course, the reasoning is lovely because of the supreme uselessness. So, yes, the supreme uselessness. And this is the work by Mr. Hardy from the 1940s, I think, and he said it's so honorable and so pure. So there's no, a few years later, the usability of relativity was demonstrated in an optically unpleasant way. Let's get to the things that I want to carry along. There are two technologies that are not entirely unimportant. The World Wide Web, I don't know if it's going to turn out important, but it was an issue of CERN, and cloud computing got some important input from the Foundation of Research at CERN, which is foundational research that is that philosophy makes clear it should be completely useless. Now I want to throw some Humboldt at you. The useless science is the most useful because it offers solutions for problems that you may not have thought of, and that a science focused on usefulness would never have dreamed to imagine. So, as a final slide, I have a summary. We need more long-term students of various genders. The university should not become more like a school in order to tackle the challenges of digitization. And I want to make you understand that the dialogue across subjects where mathematicians and information scientists should talk with social scientists, but this can only happen when you have time and space for this during your studies instead of having to constantly focus on exams. And this doesn't mean that everybody should study forever without getting a degree, but I want to emphasize that a large part of science is done by long-term students who got stuck in academia and kept programming in badly paid employment. So we should strive towards the science as defined by Humboldt. Thank you for your attention, and I hand over to Volker.
Yeah, well, I'm part two. This is my subtitle. Our main title is Wisdom of Oz, and obviously it's an allusion to the Wizard of Oz. It was his suggestion, not mine, but I'm obviously jumping on it gladly. But the moment we thought of it, we realized it's been exactly 20 years since Wizard of Oz 1 happened. Can you see it? Yeah. Sure. When I invited Richard Stallman, he was asking if OS is open source, and he was saying he wouldn't come, but I could successfully convince him that it was about an operating system. And as you can see, he was there. He had his mainframe hard disk as a halo, and gave his speech as Saint Ignatius. And the Unix Wizard was the inspiration, which was an unofficial job title in the 80s. And Ken Thompson, obviously alluding to Ken Thompson and Ritchie. And obviously another inspiration was the glorious rise of GNU Linux to the operating system of the digital age, at least on the server side. And it was about operating systems for sure, but also the first Wizard of Oz, it was also about more. For example, digital property, same as you saw with Richard Stallman, and you should probably not mention mentioned that that phrase in Stallman's presence that has bad consequences usually, but it's about this conglomerate economics, culture, computers, and about control of the DNA. Herlin was a free journalist for the Taz, and 84 to 89 he was in the European Parliament, and it was the second election of the parliament at all, and it wasn't as important in Germany back then. And both Benny Herlin and Klöckner were in jail at that time because they were in the on register for a newspaper called Radical that was prosecuted under 129A, which is advertising for a terrorist organization. So they were in jail. The German Greens put them on the list for a seat at the European Parliament, and it happened that they actually went straight from jail to the parliament, and there he was looking at genetics and founded the Genetic Interest Network. He was the coordinator of the genetic engineering campaign of Greenpeace, and the title of his talk was "The Source Code of Life: Monsanto Domain or Public Domain." Also, a topic that is still very much relevant today. He's already talked about H.G. Wells. For him, education was of paramount. He had a picture of the human in his mind, that we are learning creatures, and very important for the current developments and for the networking of humans that we experience. The measures of intercommunication and help and impairment have developed quite significantly. He was thinking about radio, the United Nations, the war. He was a proponent of world peace. He saw the system of money and intellectual property as something to be reformed. A world brain, if you look at it closely, is a network of all the institutions that concern themselves with research and with teaching, and it's not so much about a brain in itself. And the political stance that he was holding is expressed quite clearly. We don't want oligarchical parties or a dominance of class. We want a very spread out world intelligence that is aware of itself, which is alluding to the new sphere I'm going to talk about later. It needs a public opinion that is informed with information and a debate, and then it will basically it will become the super university and a worldwide encyclopedia that is being overhauled and reformed, updated with always the latest science results and research results, which connected well with the internet immediately. One of the first things that happened was called Interpedia by Rick Gates in 1993. He was a librarian that gained prominence, that he was one of the proponents of the Internet Hand, where he put out a question in the net that was to be answered with and also referenced with Internet sources and only Internet sources, so that people could understand the way the information was gained and found. So back then that was Usenet, FTP, Gopher, Telnet. Web browsers didn't exist back then. Well, 93, then he posted to a Usenet news group and suggested to create an encyclopedia, which created a lot of noise but didn't actually go anywhere. And similar fate was held for Richard Stallman's project Nupedia in 99. And actually, the same project the same thing happened to Jimmy Wales' first project, New PDA, together with Larry Singer. So the idea was that experts are writing articles and other experts are reviewing it, which was a long process and a bit tiresome, and a lot of people wanted to participate but were actually frustrated quickly. And a little later, they discovered WikiWiki by Richard Cunningham. And then what they said then was, let's just create a wiki in parallel to the expertpedia, which started as wikipedia.com, and we all know the rest. The rest is basically history. And yes, there's also another direct link to Wizard of Oz. He's the number 3 in June 2004. It was where the Wikimedia Germany registered foundation was founded. So there's a lot of complex problems and phenomena, and a central coin term for that is the Anthropocene. Basically, we're living in a world now that is completely made and or manipulated by humans. It was suggested in 2000 by two Dutch researchers, and their idea was humans have become a geological factor, and we have to take that into account somehow. And the idea for calling out a human-inspired geographical chapter had to be taken into account by geohistorians, basically. And they were arguing with climate change, climate gases, sour rain, all of the environmental effects. And they said, yeah, the first results were published and discussed on a congress in 2016 with a timeline of getting the official term coined until 2021. So if you look at a mountain and you look at the different layers, so all the way down there's the Precambrium, which was where the first animals were. Then in the Jura we have the dinosaurs, and the most top one is the Holocene. That's the last 11,000 years, the last a stable chapter after the last ice age. And then on top of that, a very a fine line, as thin as a hair, which basically be the Anthropocene. And the marker for this is the radioactive precipitation that happened after the nuclear weapons that we did in tests and in the World War II. And that has expanded so much that we now have the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. We now have a news that microplastic can be found in newly formed snow. They're so small that they basically go up into the atmosphere and come back down with the rain and the snow. This is the carbon consumption that we have. You can see 1950 is basically where it took off. You can see it better. There here in the socioeconomic trends that you can see, the graph begins 1970. I was cutting off the left chart because you can see again 1950 is where it takes off. Tourism, water consumption, fertilizers, urbanization, all of these problems expand and explode basically. This is the same in Insta. He was happy in the past, this is him now. Another anniversary, almost a year ago, is when Greta Thunberg sat in front of the parliament and was on strike. During the times of the VOS 1, it was about operating systems and knowledge, and the free OSs had their home and university, as Rüdiger was saying, and now it's about everything. Basically, the sources of our human existence and our life, our natural resources, and the hope we can have is basically into the younger generation, because we can see that they're not just interested in Fortnite, but also rebellious elements that really care about the environment and the foundations for our future. What the two anniversaries have in common is knowledge. Both come from institutions of teaching and research, both your own and the society, and knowledge can save lives, as you know. But we have a problem of complexity. That's something he also hinted at already. Our computational capacity doubles every 2 years, our data capacity every 18 months. This is a systemic complexity that increases, though, much faster. And this graph is from the Digital Manifest. It has a lot of aspects that you have to take care of. And our individual brain is just too small, if we're being honest, and it's a performative slide, and you're already overloaded with all of the information on this slide. But what is really important is all the text in the corners, too much information, not enough meaning, need to act fast, and a recipe for disaster. For the individual brain, reduction of complexity is unavoidable. At the worst case, through simple answers, populism, leaders that tell you where to go, but even in the best case, we can not escape the cognitive bias, except we put our heads together, and this is where we come to the new sphere, and we have to go back in history into the 20s, where we have a conversation between three people, where they basically came up with that term. We have the anthropologist Teilhard de Chardin, we have the mathematician Edouard Leroy, and the geologist and geochemist Vladimir Vernadsky. And the three of them were of an opinion that there's a basic model that you have the geosphere, then the biosphere on top, and on top of that there is a new sphere that is governed by knowledge and thinking. And they developed it further. Vernadsky was the beginning was the discovering of the atom and the radioactivity and the capability of gaining electricity through radioactive means or nuclear power plants. For the Jesuit religious man Jardin, it has a more a Christian meaning. Basically, the spirit leads to complexity, and then there's two phases, one of divergence and taking ownership of the earth and going into diversification of the human population. And then there's another one of convergence, where we have to get together, reach out and give a hand, where we have to work together to a hyper-personal center that is the omega point. I'm not going to do a more Christian propaganda, but this is important because this guy called Walter Ong, for all three of them that are originally involved, communication was central to the development towards the new sphere. So it was not surprising that this term also was used in the media, and it was picked up by Walter Ong. He wrote a very important book on the transition from spoken word to the written word, and he was also brought it to the attention of his teacher, Marshall McLuhan. He then took it in a very unchristian way and phrased it in that the TV, radio, satellite world all of this, he then understood the new sphere as a cosmic membrane that has put itself around the globe through electrical extension of our senses, something like a technical brain of the world. And the term new sphere was then also applied to the internet, obviously, and there was a lot of discussion around open source software. And you can think about Raymond what you want, but this text was definitely important and seminal. So here you can see a big open access repository that is called newsphere.ru.
Wir haben das Internet.
So what is left to do? We have Wikipedia, we have the internet, we have free free licenses that may solve the problem with the proprietary information and software. But we're still not at the omega point, so there's a lot to be done for organizing the information for the new sphere. So property rights that have seen a lot of change with the recent enactment of the European legislation around it, but this is basically a foundation for a lot of these things. For the platforms, it has a provision for prohibiting general surveillance of the public, for example. And I use this picture because a self-control of content within a community can work. For example, Wikipedia has a minuscule number of DMCA takedowns, so the community is actually working quite well and can handle it by themselves, which is a model that we also want to propose for the society as a whole. Here, Wells again, the idea we need a supplementation and extension, a strong public sphere with debate and informed opinion. It's partly covered by a worldwide encyclopedia, but it doesn't cover journalism. But it's what is important for him. It needs a common interpretation of reality that keeps a society as a whole together. Without it, there's no hope for getting it done. And the best we have for this is public broadcast stations, which definitely are stuck in the old world and need to have their own digitalization and end up in the news platforms and spheres. And here are some of the projects that want to create a public digital platform for discourse that is EU-wide. They're usually based on open software. I'm going to distribute the slides, if you're interested, you don't have to note down the URLs now. Decentralization of the internet is another key element for the media. 2015, a few experts published this manifest, and they said we're at a turning point. One of the ways is going to go towards dictatorship and with central control of behavior of opinions, and the other one is going to collective intelligence. Yes, we need AI, but not in the sense of artificial intelligence, but as more in the sense of collective intelligence. Here are a few examples for projects that you may know.
Mein vierter Punkt ist,
my fourth point is we need tools for thinking and for collaborating. We don't need systems that think for us, but rather systems that help us to think together. And it's not hard at all. With this very simple tool of the wiki, Ward Cunningham allowed us to write web pages, which is not revolutionary in itself, but he enabled to create or to make this to make this long-held dream of a public encyclopedia knowledge. So here is a few tools that support this endeavor. For example, Citizens Assembly in Ireland, where I'm really fascinated by it. Nextcloud, with every new project, there is a question of what do we use, and the sites. Usually we end up at some Google tools like Google Drive, but then again we already have an alternative like LibreOffice and Nextcloud. So my last point is education, and an important topic here is the Digital Pact for School that basically provided 5 billion euros to schools to enable them in teaching hardware, nets, and cloud. So if they use a cloud, which provider is it going to be? Is it going to be Microsoft, Google, Hasso-Plattner Institute, or Nextcloud maybe? Hasso-Plattner Institute also isn't a free system. So the question is, can we, as a culture of free software, to put alternatives out there like Nextcloud plus OER? And lastly, this is very dear to my heart, a general frame for politics in Europe is the digital single market. The market is at the very center, and these three people got together and talked to a few other people and found an alternative that is called Shared Digital Europe, with all of these four topics: public institutions that need to be empowered, decentralized infrastructure. We see this as a framework for operationalizing the new sphere. The wisdom of the operating systems. What is it about? So the idea is you create an analogy between the operating systems of technical and social systems, and in both senses, an infrastructure that sits on top of the other layers, for example, laws, legislation, then individual lawsuits and processes. We need to develop these operating systems with a lot of wisdom and with understanding of the environment that creates this operating system. Free licenses are a key element for this, and it needs Farsight to be sustainable, to be stable in being backwards compatible. A lot of you are already involved in one or more topics here already anyway, but we're going to keep working on it as well, and we might actually talk about it some more in some other place, but we hope we have given you an inspiration for going out into the broader, to think about the broader picture and to see where you can fit in your own workings that you're inspired by. And thanks. So if we still have time, then let's get to Q&A.
Unfortunately, not where already... We've already gone beyond our allocated time, so thank you to Rüdi and Volker. Your contact details were in the slides, and you are attending camp, so if you have any questions, then I'm sure people will know how to reach you. We'll be leaving through one of these entrances, whichever has more shade, and you can find both of us online too.